We'll see what you think of this. Under standard circumstances, we tend to think that thoughts and thinkers are quite different things, right? So let's say in the Turing machine kind of thing, you have the actual agent is the physical machine, and then you have passive data. You have patterns in some excitable medium, and the agent works on, you know, it modifies those patterns. Perhaps an observer could see patterns in its cognitive medium, right? You know, thoughts of various kinds as patterns in that medium. And so what I've been thinking about is flipping it, or more accurately dissolving the distinction, and asking to what extent can we ascribe the agency, or to take the perspective of the pattern itself as opposed to the machine, to the thinker. So the idea is, if we look at it from the on the Turing machine side, if we look at it from the perspective of the data is actually in charge, it's active data, the machine does whatever the data, you know, says, but it, and the machine is in some way just a scratch pad in the world for what has actual agency, which is the pattern in the, you know, in the data. And then you could imagine sort of a continuum of different degrees of sophistication of these patterns. I mean, we know in different mediums, different media, some patterns just sort of come and go and they dissipate immediately. Others hold themselves together. Others might compute or process information. But in all of these cases, it's the actual pattern in the medium that's doing this. And so I wonder to what extent, you know, we can say like in an embryo or in a cognitive system, you could say that it is maintaining a story by operating on these data and sort of concocting a consistent story that goes through time. But to what extent can we actually take the perspective of the pattern itself and to say that it's the pattern that propagates across, and that the degree of continuity you have, and again, it's not a fixed thing, it continuously changes, but the continuity is provided not by the physical machine that's doing it, not by the thinker, but by the pattern that in some way pulls along or resonates with, right, the structure that either can or cannot maintain it. And if it cannot maintain it, then you get birth defects and psychiatric disruptions and so on. But in the ideal case, It's the story itself, and the reason I bring this up is not only because there are some actual biomedical implications of thinking of it this way, in particular on bioelectricity, asking whether it's the body that tries to operate on bioelectric patterns or whether it's the patterns that are actually driving and pulling the biochemistry with it. There are some very specific experimental implications of that, but you know, part of I think you and I are in agreement on the need for the self to be a process, but I'm worried that it might sound to people listening that it's a kind of at least from my end, it's not meant to be a kind of deflation or a nothing buttism, you know what I mean? That it's like, well, it's a story, and in a way that it tends to reduce it, like it's just a story. It isn't, you know, it isn't real. And for me, I think it's the best kind of story there is, which is a self-referential loop that actually locks itself into existence, and it's not the physical machine that might or might not delude itself with that story, but actually it is the story is the thing, and the rest of it is just trying to sort of keep up and implement it, but the structure of the pattern is a thing, and it's, you know, to me it's a real and important thing. So what do you think about that, this idea of taking the perspective of the pattern as opposed to the machine, and thinking about things like, you know, you can have fleeting thoughts, and then you can have sort of persistent thoughts that do a little bit of niche construction in the brain and are actually quite hard to get rid of, right? You know about, I'm sure, more about this than I, but Gio Pizzullo and I just wrote something on niche construction by mental constructs, right? And then you have things like you know, maybe personality fragments, and then of course full human selves and so on. Like, what do you think about this, taking the flipping the perspective from the view of the story itself?
I think your notion of dissolving the distinction is probably the best, easiest way for me to think about this, because for me it is just the pattern. I struggle to find the machine that is not part of the pattern. And I say that in the spirit of mortal computation. which I know you would be fully committed to, and meant in the sense that Jeff Hinton originally introduced, and Alex Obida has certainly promoted recently. So, from that point of view, mortal computation is just an acknowledgement that it is the patterns that matter. And that's where the dynamics are. That's where the self-organization is. And there is a substrate. It could be a sort of, an electrochemical substrate, or it could be possibly a von Neumann architecture. But if you move into the world of von Neumann architectures and Turing machines, I think you're outside the world of natural physics and natural intelligence. And you're talking about simulation machines, which we have built, and it may be that that's what requires the dissolution, the realization that simulations of self-organization and pattern formation on a Turing architect, on a von Neumann architecture with read and write to memory, renders the software immortal, because you can run that pattern formation on any Turing machine, is a distraction. And the really interesting questions and the physics of all of this and the interpretation, and certainly sort of understanding practically the implications for biotic self-organization are actually in the patterns. So when I was talking about states before, I was just talking about the particular pattern at the moment, without any scaffolding or any structure in play to. Do the computing. So for me, the pattern is the data. It is the dynamics. It's all the same thing. And then the trick is, where does the self come from? Well, it's when one pattern somehow distinguishes itself from another pattern. How do you do that? You have to separate them. How do you do that? Well, you define the inputs and outputs, or you define a Markov blanket, or if you were Chris Fields, you'd put a holographic screen in between them. But it's all about the patterns. Mm-hmm. So that's how I would say. Having said that, there is an interesting, because you mentioned niche construction, there is a, in conversation with people thinking at a slightly higher level in terms of communication and hermeneutics and language, there might be a related kind of argument that the culture, there might be a cultural environment out there. So I'm thinking now about the separation between the observer as a phenotype and the eco niche. Mm-hmm. And certainly from the point of view of the free energy principle, if you read the observer making sense of data supplied from the environment as this constructive, active self-organization that can be read as creating explanations, then the converse is exactly true. There's an exact mathematical symmetry that the environment must also be learning from and making sense of the things that are observing it. So the environment observes the denizens of any particular eco niche. On that view, you could actually argue that the environment could be a cultural environment. It could be an environment of memes, of knowledge, of books, for example. And I can't remember whether you've written about this, but I suspect you have. But you could look at books as the agent, as particular patterns.
Yeah.
That are actually, from the point of view of natural selection, much better than we are in terms of lasting longer than your typical human being. And you're reading the book as actually learning from, at a very slow time scale, those symmetries and invariants of the its environment, which of course are the little human beings that sort of create printing presses and write stories. So that distinction, which I think is distinct from the mortal computation argument, where there is no distinction. The substrate is a pattern. The pattern is the substrate. Once one puts time into play, that would be one sort of way of dissolving the problem. But there may be something beyond that that you were intimating, which is the patterns could be of an encultured sort, and could be treated as an observer of the the culture creating or co-constructing artifacts that generate this particular environment.
What if anything does that say about this? You know, the distinction and the argument between organic and psychological disease. Like, does that inform that issue?
Again, for me, that distinction is somewhat dissolved by the very arguments that you're making. So in the context of mortal computational self-organization read as inference, then we are talking about the organic, the organismal self-organization subtending belief updating. And as such, you're talking about psychology. So for me, the two, perhaps they have dual aspects of the same thing, you know, in the sense that, you know, there is this information theory you could apply to neuronal dynamics and neurochemistry and electrochemistry and pharmacology. But this is exactly the same mortal substrate that holds the meaning in terms of standing in for the sufficient statistics or beliefs about the causes of this system's sensations. So, I mean, that plays out in the context of psychopathology very, very clearly in terms of something you were talking about earlier on, which is sort of attending to this and that, even in a deterministic system. So attention in this instance is just another aspect of this sense-making. And if you break that, then you have a powerful mechanistic explanation for a large range of psychiatric and neurological conditions that can all be cast in terms of some kind of false inference that is all explained in terms of a certain disattention or a failure to attend to the right kind of things or ignore the right kind of things, you know, ranging from hallucinations and delusions right through to say dysmorphophobia, you know, abnormal beliefs about my body, for example. And then coming back to your favorite example, of course, cancer, just having beliefs about the boundaries of my, you know, of my cell or myself, which could, you know, in a Freudian sense, be associated with ego boundaries. So inferences about what the boundaries are, which again brings us back to sort of self-modeling and, you know, whether, you know, this interesting notion that the self can be observed. You haven't mentioned the paper about can you ever know yourself with Chris and the Gödelian arguments that you can't. I thought you might bring that to the table.
Yeah. New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.